As I keep telling people, fighter pilots fit into a very narrow demographic of the general population. And we're egotistical, we're very overconfident, and we like each other because we're almost the same as each other. So, and the best example I can have of that is when I went to meet the guy who was to train me on the MiG-21, I walked into his hotel room and it was 9 o'clock in the morning, and he was a Slovakian general, and he put a glass of Slivovitz in my hand and said, let's skull this. And I went, yep, you're a fighter pilot.
Hey everyone, Vincent Aiello here, call sign Jello, host of the Fighter Pilot Podcast. This week we have another repurposed happy hour. It's from the COVID pandemic time, and it features an Australian guest who holds the distinction of the oldest and longest serving fighter pilot ever. Now, it was recorded on Zoom, so as always, the audio and video quality aren't quite as good, but I know you're going to enjoy the discussion. Here we go.
Well, I appreciate you willing to join us here, Frawls. And I'll tell you this much. I've had a lot of different people entertain me, if you will, on this show in various capacities. I don't think I've ever had a Guinness Book of World Record holder. So don't you fall into that elite category?
Yes. Yes, I do. Yes.
Come on, tell us about
it. I keep telling people, not that I'm the best fighter pilot or the worst fighter pilot, just the bloody oldest.
Now, I have to ask this, though, because as I was doing a little research, I'd heard about you the last few years, but in preparation for a meeting with you today, I, of course, Googled your name and saw. Is it just that you were the oldest pilot flying a fighter? Because with all the airplanes these days flying, as we call it, the commercial services here in the States,
yeah,
I got to think there's some old timers doing that, but maybe not.
Well, the criteria for it was to be part of an air force and be operational. So in that respect, you had to be able to be called out to go to war.
So, I see.
Yeah. And in that respect, if it came down to me, they were in a lot of trouble.
Well, hopefully they can count on the, as I read, 499 students that you train. Come on. How did you not find someone and say, you're my student for a week? Here we go.
Man, I must have recounted that about 15 times. I went through, I said, surely I made it to 500. Crying out loud, no, I didn't. I mean, I've had more students than that, foreign students and things like that, but that was just Australian.
And then 49 and a half years of consecutive service in the Royal Australian Air Force?
Yep, yep. I did 5 years in Saudi Arabia as well. I was still a reservist with the Air Force, and I went over there to train their kids to be fighter pilots. And as it was a thing that was sort of sanctioned by the Australian government, so, you know, support for foreign allies kind of deal. Mm. Yeah.
I had a gentleman on the show recently to discuss his very good book. I think it's Phantoms to Warthog, something like that. And he actually trained our friends at the time in Iran before the big fall. So I can imagine you enjoyed your experiences in some ways and others, huh?
Yeah, the flying in Saudi Arabia was absolutely amazing. It really was. It was very, very good. It was kind of a little like it was when we were flying in the early 80s and things like that. So the rules, for instance, for low flying was don't hit the ground. So it was pretty impressive. So the terrain in that we flew through, particularly in the west of the country, was amazing. It really was. Yeah.
Yeah.
Some of the students were a challenge, but I point out to some people that the best student I ever had in my whole career was a Saudi.
Is that right?
I've never come across a guy who was an absolute natural, and this guy was. He flew much better than me. He ended up going on to F-15, so I haven't heard from him since, but he was astounding.
Wow.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Let me put you on the spot, Frawls, though. What, so natural ability, I mean, you could argue that is given or, you know, whatever other method, but what makes a good student? You've seen a lot of them.
Yeah. I think for me, you know, somebody who's dedicated and, responsive, I suppose. Mm. I mean, I was never ever a natural pilot, and I've got plenty of witnesses who will attest to that. But I think, you know, and the beauty of training fighter kids is that they are really heavily motivated. They want to be there. They want to be a fighter pilot. And you are just participating in letting them get along to their dream, you know. So, you know, to that extent, that's where the joy and that comes from of training these kids. And but yeah, so in that regard, I mean, I did some ab initio training earlier on in my instructional career, and that was you know, from time to time kind of challenging and disappointing, because you give your best to try and get a kid through and he doesn't make it. So
but
the fighter training was great. Loved it.
Yeah. Did you find, so I'm gonna rely on you here, if you don't mind, for some questions, assumptions, if you will, on my part. Yep. And I don't know if you're familiar with the Fighter Pilot podcast. I don't assume to be the fighter pilot. It's just a show that I started, and that's the name. So I spent not quite 25 years in the Navy and flew F-18s primarily, F-16s a little bit. And so I have this show, and suddenly I become the authority. In fact, someone was just questioning me the other day, so because they asked me, hey, if you shoot down a drone, is that an aerial victory? And if you get five of them, are you an ace? And I thought, I don't know. I don't think so. I think it should be another person. So yeah. I'm gonna put some of the questions that I get to you. But I want to start with, since you've flown in Saudi Arabia, getting back to that,
yep.
Do you agree with me that the people in our line of work are more or less the same all over the world, no matter their accents or nationality or anything else? I mean, I've always said we're kind of from the same cloth, but we also are in a sense not of this earth. In other words, those who have flown, I think they know something that those who are earthbound don't know.
Exactly right. As I keep telling people, fighter pilots fit into a very narrow demographic of the general population. And we're egotistical, we're overconfident, and we like each other because we're almost the same as each other. So. And the best example I can have of that is when I went to meet the guy who was to train me on the MiG-21, I walked into his hotel room, and it was 9 o'clock in the morning, and he was a Slovakian general, and he put a glass of Slivovitz in my hand and said, let's skull this. And I went, yep, you're a fighter pilot. And he was, you know, I was just, excuse me, I was just intrigued to see what an Eastern Bloc trained fighter pilot would be like. And he was just like me, you know, he really was. He was a wonderful man. Yeah, fantastic.
I would say some of the things I tell people on my show is we don't suffer fools, right?
No.
Because when you're in charge of a 30,000 pound airplane with bombs and fuel and weapons and speed and all those things, you have to be very put together. And so you can't handle or tolerate, I can't, anyone who really doesn't have the ability to do that. I don't know. It's not only that we don't suffer fools. I feel like it's like, you know, either do it or don't, but don't dilly dally. You know, I don't know. I'm not really making a point, I guess, but.
Yeah, I'm exactly like that. Something needs to be done. We do it now. We don't muck around. We do it and we do it to the best of our ability so that nobody has any cause to question us, you know?
Yeah. Also, I can't stand not being on time because I'm just so used to doing that in our career. You know, if you're expected to be somewhere, then you're there. And so there's an element to that. But
the way I see it, if I'm 15 minutes early, I'm 10 minutes late.
There you go. Now, and help me out with, again, the question that I suddenly became the expert on, which I didn't want to be. So in your mind, when you go out in a fighter plane, you can employ ordnance on ground targets, air targets, et cetera. So mm-hmm. if you blow up a tank, if you blow up five tanks, that doesn't make you anything special. To me, if you shoot down a drone that happens to be flying, I don't think that counts. So what do you think? What's the definition of an ace?
No. The definition of an ace is fighting against guys, you know, who are of the same ilk. So, you know, you don't get in the ring as a boxer and beat up a robot, do you?
There you go. That's probably a good way to put it.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I agree with that. And then just getting back to the students, have you had some, I assume you have over your years, have you had students who maybe didn't either end up in the airplane they wanted or maybe washed out or went somewhere else, and how they handled that as part of the character of their being? Did you ever have to counsel people on that?
Oh, yeah, all the time. I mean, when I was the commanding officer of the training squadron many years ago, that was one of my duties, is to tell a kid that his dream bubble had dispersed and he wouldn't be staying on with us. And that's a pretty difficult thing to do. Yeah. I might point out that it happened to me. So I came off my pilot training and I went to Mirages initially and got washed out. And then I went to C-130s for 5 years and then came back. So, you know, I was determined I was going to be a fighter pilot some way or another, and I managed to do it. So, yeah.
Yeah. Wow. Well, you did it for, if I read correctly, 49.5 years again. So yeah, close. They wouldn't keep you for another 6 months?
You know, it was my decision. Okay. It just got to the point because the F-35 was coming into service, and the F-18, which you may be aware of, as it was coming to the end of its service, was incredibly much more capable than when I flew it. And so I'm an instructor instructing on tactics that I've never used. So it just got to the point where I went, you know what, this is like a reality show. It's not real, you know. And so, you know, I just thought I'd just bow out. You know, you see footballers and people like that who go, you know what, I know it's time. And, you know, it would have been nice to do 50 years, but that wasn't the point. The point was, am I going to be useful, you know?
Right.
And I just decided I wasn't going to be, yeah.
Another question I want to ask you is, I feel like the demographics of fighter pilots have changed. Now, I don't know very much about Australian fighter pilots, although I assume they're fairly similar. But if you look at the American culture in the 70s and 80s, you had the F4 and F14, somewhat very macho, but not maybe very cerebral type of fighter pilot. And I don't mean to categorize, but bear with me. Today, I feel like they're much more analytical, much more able to think in three dimensions and quickly. I wonder what your experience has been, again, with your half a century almost of flying experience. How have you seen the demographic of a fighter pilot change?
It's changed markedly. Like you say, the earlier, you know, in the early days when I was training these kids, you know, they were just like me. They were aggressive and, you know, good hands and feet men, whereas these days the kids are good computer gamers, you know, and that's where the jet is these days, you know. The Hawk that I was training on had an F-18 cockpit in it, and, you know, they picked up on the logic really, really quickly, whereas such a our old timers like me, you know, a little while to get on top of all of that sort of stuff. But, yeah, and I did fly the F-35 simulator for about half an hour, and that was just incredible. And I went, yep, I've got no idea.
I'm out.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, thanks. Here's your money.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Well, I don't think anyone can accuse you of shirking your duties or otherwise. You certainly have amazing experiences. So I wonder, I'm sure you have them readily at hand, but the articles I read, you weren't quite all the way done. So give us the final total numbers. I read over 10,000 flight hours and so many in fighters. So
I just clicked over 10,000 hours just before I retired, and 6,000 of that was on fighter airplanes. Admittedly, a lot of that was the last one, the Hawk 127, which I had 2,500 hours on. But,
wow. Takeoffs and landings equal?
The only time I ever parachuted, I was pushed out of the back of a transport aeroplane against my will. But
I mean, for a lot of 6,000 hours in ejection seats, that's actually pretty impressive. How about single engine aircraft? Probably a lot of it, or most of it.
Well, I flew the Mirage for 5 years. That was single engine, and the Hawk, naturally enough, is a single engine airplane. So, the Mirage was a real manly airplane, that's for sure.
Which Mirage? And,
sorry, Mirage 3O.
Okay.
Yeah, Dassault Mirage 3O. So most of that, except for on the Hornet, was single engine.
Wow. Yeah. All right. So I don't know if we want to go through and list all the aircraft you've flown, and you can certainly do that if you want. But my question at the end is going to be, imagining if you were current now, and maybe you are, that's a question to itself, but imagining that you could walk out to any one of them and kind of program yourself to be prepared to go fly it. So, you know, obviously you have to do the exams and prepare yourself. But if there was one of those that you could go jump in, Frawls, what would it be? Just go putz around for a day.
MiG 21.
MiG 21, really? Why so?
I was just really, really impressed with its reliability, with the systems that it had in it, having flown the Mirage. The MiG 21, the systems were so simple, but so incredibly effective. You know, in the Mirage, for instance, when you went supersonic, it had a flight controls computer. It was analog. But that flight controls computer prevented you using the elevons too much when you were supersonic. So it, you know, drove the hydraulic packs to a certain position and stuff like that to prevent all of that going on. In the MiG-21, it was a rack and pinion. It just moved along the rack as you got faster and faster. It's unbelievable.
Brilliant.
You know? And it had a panic button. On the top of the stick, there's a white button. You get into an unusual attitude, you just press the button, the autopilot or re-erect the airplane. You weren't allowed to use it below 3,000 metres, so obviously it took a while for it to take effect. But, but it was just, you know, it was just a great airplane. Having a symmetrical aerofoil, its ability to decelerate and accelerate was quite incredible. I showed the airplane for a couple of years on demonstration flights all around the country. Yeah, it's an amazing airplane. Not taking away from the Hornet. I love the Hornet too.
No, I agree. The Hornet's the Hornet is very good at a lot of things, but there's not, like, in my opinion, one of those that really gets you excited. Maybe the slow speed dogfighting, I guess. I wanted to ask you about flying the MiG-21 in IMC, because we had a guest on the show talking about exploitation programs. Brian McCoy, I believe, was his name. And he said that they weren't allowed, when they flew them here near Vegas, to go into the clouds because the attitude reference was, I guess, backwards from what we are used to.
Yeah, really strange. Well, the MiG-15, I flew that for a little while, and the attitude indicator had brown at the top and blue at the bottom. And you just went, you know, if you change the wires around, it'll work properly. But the MiG-21, just like the L-39 that I fly now, the attitude indicator, the actual aeroplane symbol, gives you bank angle, and the card in the back goes up and down to give you pitch angle. But never flew anywhere near a cloud in the MiG-21 ever.
I don't blame you. My goodness. Did you get it to Mach 2?
No, we actually tried one day. Air traffic control in Australia are quite different to those around the world. And we tried to do a Mach run one day with one of the owners in the back seat, and they wouldn't let us do it. We went out over the sea, but they reckon they couldn't see us on our transponder, so they wouldn't let us do it. But I did sort of touch it, Mach 1, at an air show one day and got into trouble. But,
ooh, I bet. All right.
The thing didn't accelerate. Yeah.
What was the fastest you'd ever flown, let's call it Mach, and in what aircraft?
Mach 2 and the Mirage 3.
Mach 2 and the Mirage 3. Okay. Yeah. How about either true or ground, if you ever happened to catch either one of those?
What do you mean, true airspeed you're talking about?
Yeah. Do you remember seeing, like...
Well, Mach 2, as I recall, when I did the run, was about 620 knots at about 38,000 feet. So that's pretty impressive. That's, as far as, you know, down low, close to the ground, again, the Mirage, 600 knots, do that very, very easily.
Wow. Yeah. How about the highest you ever flew, and what was it in?
The highest I ever flew was in the Mirage, and I didn't really, was not trying to fly high. I just managed to screw it up. But I was doing an intercept on a Canberra bomber one night, and he was up at about, I think, what would be 41,000 feet. And I was, so he was in the 1 to 4s, and I was in the 6 to 9, so I was at 38,000, 39,000 feet. And the Mirage, when you did a turn, at those heights, you had to go into afterburner. And I was having trouble getting the camber on the radar because the Mirage radar wasn't all that good. And I came around behind him, and I couldn't get him on the radar, and it was just frustrating me. And I was working my tail off trying to get the camber on the radar, and I just couldn't get him. I just didn't know what was going on. And I looked in, and I'd set an attitude of about 10 degrees nose up, and I flew through about 55, 56,000 feet as I realised this. 55,000 feet was the maximum you could go on the Mirage. And in my panic, I bunted, and you know what happens when you bunt a jet in full burner, it just accelerated and kept climbing. So I didn't know. You know, I just sat there and just kept the bump going because I had no idea. It was nighttime, so I had no idea what I was doing. Anyway, so I imagine I got to almost 60,000 feet, I suppose, something
wow.
like that. But the epilogue to the story was as I came down and sort of composed myself again, I flew 1.5 miles in front of the camber, who promptly shot me.
Well, you did caveat at the beginning. You didn't claim to ever be the best.
No, that's right. Yeah. When it comes to hamburger stories, I've got a lot of them.
Oh, my. Well, that's yet another reinforcement. I can't think of a better word suddenly that I was hoping for from you, which is we're not like our counterparts in Hollywood, I would say.
No.
Most of us are not too full of ourselves. In fact, we're quite ready to poke fun at ourselves.
Oh, yeah. Well, you need to join in with the majority in that case. you know what it's like being in a crew room or being in a bar. You know, you just make one slip up and you're going to wear that for weeks on end. You know, we've all done that.
All right, another question I want to ask you is: did you ever have a parent who was a student at one point, and then a son or daughter?
I had a stepfather who was on pilot's course during World War II, very late in the piece, and the war ended and he got demobbed. So that's pretty much where I got my interest in flying, although I seem to recall that I had it anyway. And I have two sons and neither of them are in the least bit interested. So,
that's because it's been too available their whole lives, right?
Yeah, overexposure is what it is. I mean, when that damn movie Top Gun came out, my eldest boy decided, I think I'll be a fighter pilot. I said, mate, that's not the motivation. Just because you saw it in a movie, it doesn't work like that, you know.
Yeah, right. Let me rephrase my question, Frawls. Did you ever have a student of yours, a flight student, who then you had that person's son or daughter later?
No, did not. No.
Okay.
No.
That's fine.
Now, I had peers whose sons came through, but I hadn't trained them, you know.
Okay.
So my peers, yeah.
No, it's fun. You're a bit of a unicorn, so I'm just exploring the dance floor here, if you will, to see what you have and haven't done. I mean, for heaven's sakes, you've been in the Royal Air Force for half of its existence. Doesn't it turn 100 here soon?
Yeah, 100 years on the 31st of March, yeah.
Well, what are they going to do? Anything fancy?
They've got all sorts of things planned, naturally fly pass, you know, everywhere sort of thing. So, you know, the local base here, the fighter base, Williamtown, they've got lots of things going on.
Good.
Yeah, I've even been invited to a couple. How about that?
Oh, I bet you're a bit of a celebrity. Now, our first feature on the podcast with an Australian crew will be episode 111. And guess what? It's the F111. And I bet you know these gentlemen, but we got Leo and, Mero to be on there. So the deputy chief and then one of the past chiefs. And they're going to talk about the F111. Did you ever get a ride in the F111?
No, I went up to Amberley to get a ride. I was offered a ride, but you had to, because you sat in the right seat, there were some things on the right-hand side that the pilot couldn't reach that you need to do, you know, you need to know how to do and what to do with it. So you had to do a simulator ride first and foremost, but the simulator broke, so I missed out. Oh. Yeah.
All right. Any other aircraft where you got a one-time ride that you wouldn't count necessarily as your... I mean, obviously, you've flown a lot of aircraft, the Hawk and the F-18, but any other one-offs?
P-51 I flew in the back seat. It was a two-seater, so I got a bit of a go at that. But, you know,
nice.
I'm still trying to get myself into the front seat of one, but they're a bit rare here in Australia. There's only about half a dozen of them, and rightly so. The people who own them are going, don't touch my airplane.
Yeah, it's a shame that at the end of World War II, it took a little time to quit building them, so they would build them and destroy them right away. And boy, if they could have just put those in climate-controlled storage for 70 years, wouldn't that be amazing?
Yeah, exactly right. Oh, yeah, great.
What else is on your wish list?
That's about it, really, because I've flown a lot of warbirds. You know, I've flown the Kitty Hawk, the Hawk of Sea Fury, T-28 Trojan, a couple others, Tiger Moth, things like that. Just the Mustang, because, you know, I'm pretty satisfied with a lot of the aeroplanes that I flew. Great experiences. The Sabre, you know, I flew the F-86.
Nice.
As a demonstration pilot, that was a great experience as well. Yeah.
Well, you really have done it all, Frawls. That's pretty impressive. And you're still flying, you said, what, an L-39?
Yeah, fly the L-39. We've got a little, well, I don't own it, but a friend of mine's got a company here and we just do adventure flights with it. So I get to go flying, you know, every third or fourth weekend, just go up and do four or five trips in it. Yeah, it's a nice, easy little aeroplane to fly. Yeah, like any jet, it'll still bite you if you're not paying attention. But
of course. Yeah. Of course. I remember when I was in flight school, I forget what base it was, but they had a flying club and I went over to learn the Cessna 172 or something.
Oh, yeah.
And I thought I was actually more nervous flying in that than I was in my regular airplane because I didn't know it as well as the military always makes you know every system so well. And I thought if you're at 1,000 feet or lower, but the point being is you can die just as quickly at 70 or 80 knots in a general aviation aircraft as you can in a fighter.
Yeah, exactly right. Yeah, there's no two ways about that.
Did you lose many friends over your service? I have to think you did.
Yes, I did, yeah. I lost a very good friend in an F-111 crash here in Australia. With a nighttime mission. He and I were crash buddies on an instructor course, and, we really got on very, very well. Lost a couple other guys down the track in other accidents. It's one of those things, you know, I mean, I've come close several times myself, you know, but like every fighter pilot, if you thought too much about it, you'd throw your wings in the bin and give it up. But, you know, that was bad. I'm moving on from here. So, you know, and that's pretty much what you sort of do. I guess it's part of your training, isn't it? You know, you do all this emergency handling and stuff like that and those things that happen in life which you automatically sort of treat as an emergency. You just go, yep, that was really, really bad. I'm really sad about that, but, I'm moving on.
Yeah. Well, you have to. If you're going to let it bother you, like you said, you're not going to be able to continue to be effective. So.
No, that's right, yeah.
So, all right, so you're still flying. I don't know. Did there ever come a time when it became a chore or a grind, or did you always? I mean, obviously there are good days and bad days, I guess. But you still do it every few weekends, so you still enjoy it.
Yeah, I love it. Yeah, I really do. It's an addiction, you know. I mean, like any fighter pilot, my back and neck really hurt me all the time.
Yeah.
And, you know, what's the definition of an addiction? You're doing something that's hurting you, but you won't give it up.
There you go. That's as good a definition as there is.
Yeah.
Tell me about the, I read that you instructed in the F-18, but the particular article I read that in didn't say anything about your experiences in the F-18. Were you at some point like a frontline, I don't know what else to call it, but a fleet pilot in the Hornet and then went back to instruct, or did you just learn it?
I did an operational tour, and I was XO 77 squadron on the F-18, and then I went to OCU. Funnily enough, I did my course on the F-18, and as I graduated, I then became the training flight commander for F-18 in the conversion unit. So I did my instruction, I suppose, before I did an operational tour, and then I went and did an operational tour after that. Yeah.
But with your experience and hours and duration, I don't know, does there come a point where, granted, the T-28, I understand, probably has some fairly significant P factor when you really firewall the throttle, but does there come a point where an airplane is an airplane and they all kind of give you the same messages, if you will, as you fly it? You can kind of cue in on certain indicators that you're in trouble or not?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, if you ask me what the checklist was in the L-39, I wouldn't be able to tell you. But as soon as I get into the cockpit, I know. And, you know, I just sort of assimilate with the airplane. Mm-hmm. You know, the T-28, like you say, is a very powerful airplane. Beat a P-51 to, I think, 3,000 feet, doesn't it, or something like that. That's some amazing thing that the T-28 is capable of, somebody told me. I'm not sure if that's true, but somebody did tell me that. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the T-28 is a very powerful aeroplane, like you say. I actually had an emergency in one where the prop governor failed. So I only had fine pitch. I couldn't get any pitch whatsoever. I had a student in the front seat who actually owned the aeroplane. Oh. And I could only get the aeroplane to 300 feet in the circuit to try and, you know, get it back on the ground. So that was a bit of a scary moment for me. I'm going to wipe my nose again, sorry.
That's all right.
But, you know, you just jump into an aeroplane and, you know, you appreciate what it's good at, what it's not good at, you know, those parts of the envelope that you avoid, you know. The L-39 has a really strange stall. It doesn't actually, it's got a supercritical airfoil. It doesn't actually stall like a normal airplane. It sort of mushes and goes like that. It will eventually give you the standard stall indication, but leading up to that, you don't sort of appreciate you losing altitude. It's a strange thing. Yeah. And that's just an example of, you know, you get to know your airplane. I mean, the F-86, that was nasty with the gear and the flap down. If you had any slip or skid in a turn, that thing would spin immediately. Yeah. And I know that because I did it.
Oh, gosh. And obviously lived to tell.
Yeah. Well, I hadn't flown it for a while, so I just took it up to 10,000 feet and did the standard things that you're supposed to do. Did a clean stall and then did a dirty stall and looked inside, and the skid ball was slightly out, and I just touched the rudder and she spun immediately. So, managed to get it out naturally enough, but and I didn't overspeed the gear or flap, which was quite. I was working pretty fast.
Better lucky than good, they say, right?
Yeah, exactly right.
Yeah. I'm all over the map here, Frawls, but I want to ask you one about night vision goggles. Is that something you did much of at all?
I did not ever use them. We did a visit over to the States. We went down to Phoenix where they were developing them, and we tried them on in a dark room. And that's my only experience with night vision goggles. Funnily enough, a lot of the guys on the fighters these days, they don't like going night flying unless they've got goggles. And I'm going, Jesus, mate. I spend a lot of my life at night, you know, being scared and flying formation on other guys and, you know, all of this sort of stuff. And you're complaining because you can't have a pair of goggles to go night flying? Forget about it.
Yeah. Well, I would put myself in the latter camp, because once you have them, you know how nice they are. The only bummer is you have to keep scanning to build the picture, because you're looking through the little optics. but
yeah, well, I, you know, I've scared myself a lot of times night flying and that, and you just go back to it and just go, well, that's part of life, you know, you just got to keep going.
Yeah.
You don't tell that in the bar after night flying, but.
Oh, boy. Wow. So one thing I don't know real well about the Royal Australian Air Force is there, I think like in the British services, you can go like one path and basically stay flying, or you can go another path and work your way up the ladder, if you will. Is that true?
Yeah.
Where you are? Is that how you stayed flying the whole time?
Yes, it is. Yes. After I became, after I was the CIO of a squadron, I just decided that, you know, I didn't want to become, you know, a guy behind a desk sort of thing. And, you know, I wasn't really academically brilliant by any stretch of the imagination. And again, I have witnesses who will say my staff work wasn't all that brilliant. So
maybe on purpose.
yeah. But so what I did is I joined the reserves at the end of my flying career. And then I went to Saudi for 5 years and came back and stayed in the reserves. So I could stay flying. I'm going to cough, sorry. that's how I managed it. All of my contemporaries and some of my students became very high up in our Air Force. But, you know, they ended up retiring with, you know, 4,500 hours flying, whereas, you know, yeah. I just kept on going. Yeah.
Well, that's great. Are you at a point in your life where you don't need to worry about other work? Are you fully retired, or are you doing some consulting, or what else are you doing?
Okay, well, I am the crew chief for the World Water Speed Record Challenge, Warby Motorsport. They have a jet-powered boat, and so I run all the team and the crew and everything like that. And advise Dave Warby, who's going for the record, how to go about things, do the programming, et cetera, et cetera. So that keeps me busy. In fact, I'm going over to work on the boat just after this. So we've had the boat up to 250 mile an hour so far.
Wow.
And I'm also secretary of the our local Return Services League, so Veterans League. So, yeah.
Good.
So that keeps me on my toes. All right. I'm also, like most fighter pilots, I'm a car guy, so I like tinkering with cars.
Oh, yes.
And, yeah. That keeps me busy as well.
Yeah, I'm sure. How about a book?
I'll go back to my staff work.
First, yeah. Well, you don't seem one to want to self-aggrandize, but there could be some very interesting anecdotes that you have from your extensive experience that could be valuable to people.
Yeah. I've written some blogs on that on my website. You know, one is how you want to become a RAF pilot and how to go about that sort of thing. So, you know. Well, the problem is, too, at my age, I can't remember a lot of stuff. So. you run the risk of going, I'm pretty sure that's what had happened. Let's put that down on paper. And somebody comes back later on and says, I read your book. That's crap. That never happened. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Well, our brains are fallible, let's say. At least mine certainly is. Oh, dear me. Like I said, I didn't write notes down because I thought I would just go wherever my imagination took me. But you've been a good sport, and I can see that you're trying to fight off this cold, so I don't want to keep it too long. But
that's all right.
I wonder if you it's fun to just talk about it, isn't it? I wonder, though, if you did like in maybe in your blogs, you've already covered this, but did you have you come up with any, you know, axioms, if you will, or best practices, maybe is another way to put it, for the folks that do want to become flight students? And we talked at the beginning about the Saudi student who was very talented, but also put forth the effort and obviously listens and adapts the lessons you're telling. But I wonder if you have any, like I said, just sayings from your extensive experience, like, if you do this, then this will happen, or, you know, anything. Yeah, that was obviously very simplified, but.
Well, Yeah, most of the advice I give to my students is, you know, it's going to be bloody hard, but there's a light at the end of the tunnel, and you just need to make that light at the end of the tunnel bigger and bigger and bigger until you get out, sort of thing. Mm. You know, there's lots of things that I've told students kind of escape me at the moment. There's the old memory going down the gurgler again. you know, I guess being, you know, at my ability, we talked about it before, I'd rather be lucky than good. So,
wow.
But, you know, there's no substitute for hard work, dedication, you know, and you know, really studying hard. And, you know, that was the other thing that was becoming a bit of a grind for me towards the end of my career. You know, being an instructor, you turn up for work each day and you better be 105% as the absolute minimum. You have to look your best, you have to be your best, and your knowledge has to be exemplary. There's no point having a student ask you a question and you go, I don't know, you know. Yeah. And that just, you know, destroys your credibility right then and there. So,
yeah.
You know, and towards the end, getting into the books pretty much on a daily basis and making sure that your knowledge was up to the correct standard was really hard. But the other thing in it, that, you know, the week after I retired, I sort of went through a bit of a withdrawal, and then I suddenly realised I'm not going to have an instructor rating test, I'm not going to have an instrument rating test, I'm not going to have a no-notice emergency test, no-notice emergency simulator, you know, all these tests and evaluations that you do through your career, which, you know, you just go from time to time. But in our Air Force, we also had to do online campus for things like equity and diversity and fraud and all this sort of stuff, and you had to do it on a yearly basis, you know. And there are exams on that. And towards the end, it was very, very tedious, you know, really.
Yes. No, I don't doubt that. Did you ever find it, though, somewhat, I don't know, frustrating, for lack of a better word, to see? I would think some student mistakes are very common and you would see them repeatedly. Was that
the case? Oh, yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Did that get fatiguing?
The one that comes to mind is designating with bank on in a Hornet. That used to drive me nuts. You know, guy roll in and, you know, have 20 degrees angle of bank and then designate and then roll out and go, where's it gone? Designate with bank on. Oh, geez. Yeah. You know, that was a really common mistake. Yeah. And you know, in 1v1 tactics and that, you know, getting too slow, you know, pulling too hard and restoring the jet and stuff like that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but that were very common things. Funnily enough, I found that female fighter pilots wouldn't do that as much. They tended to feel the airplane a bit better. And I was fortunate enough, the first two F-18 pilots that we managed to graduate, I was involved with their training, and they were really good kids, and they had a really good feel for the airplane. And it's strange to, you know, for guys of my ilk, it's strange to have a female voice in the front seat and they're doing really, really well, you know, and you go, this kid can fight, you know. And they were really good, very, very competitive, which I thought was great, you know. They did a great job.
Yeah. That's good.
But I found the boys just a bit more mechanical initially, you know, and you'd say, crying out loud, mate, feel the jet, it's talking to you, you know? It's trying to tell you what it can't do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's right, you know. There's a guy over there, pull for your life, you know, and you just go, that didn't work, did it?
More is better, some of us think. And, yeah, I definitely fell into that trap early in my dogfighting experiences is, oh, he's over there, I'll just keep pulling and run out of air.
Well, I guess to a certain extent in the Hornet, you could get away with it a lot of the times, you know, because the thing would go really, really slow, you know. I had a 1v1 with an F-15 colonel who insisted on seeing my film, and I was on the inside of his circle gunning him, and I had about, 55 or 60 degrees angle of attack, and I was about 105 knots, and he was incensed. he said, "What are your limits?" And I said, "Oh, we don't have a limit." And he stormed out.
Whatever it takes to gun you.
That's right, yeah.
So on that note, if you walked into the ready room, or whatever you would call it, and they have two open flights, Frawls, and one is an air-to-ground training sortie of some part, and you can decide what kind of bombs maybe, or one was an air-to-air BFM or something, and you can, again, decide on who you would fight. Which one would you put your name in the hat for? Which one did you enjoy more?
BFM every day.
Is that right?
Every day. Okay. I love it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That was one of my fortes. I was actually quite good at BFM. Never ever lost rolling scissors. There's a claim for you.
Never lost at a rolling scissors.
Never ever lost a rolling scissors. And I fought pretty good guys.
Wow.
Got shot in other places, but
Hasn't? Who hasn't? All right. So not to defend the other side, but did you find satisfaction though in dropping? I assume you had the small practice blue bombs like we do here in the States on our Hornets, but didn't you find some satisfaction in dropping that from several thousand feet up and having it hit very close to where you intended?
Oh yeah, yeah. I remember I dropped two 1,000 pounders early on in my career off the Hornet, and I can't remember what the release height, 8,000 or 9,000, and you know, pulled out, and the shockwave of the bombs going off hit the jet as I was going through about 13,000 or 14,000 feet, and I thought, man, that is power. And the other one I did, I was doing a night CAS mission, and threw a 500 pounder into the range, and you know, did what you're not supposed to do, look over my shoulder and see if I can see it go off. And it was amazing to see the ground glow red around the strike for about, you know, half a second. But that's pretty impressive. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, wow. But, I think, you know, being a fighter pilot, being able to accurately deliver your bombs, you know, just put them in there, particularly on a TOT or something like that, being able to do that really, really accurately is very satisfying.
Satisfying. And to be fair, it's probably far easier today than it's ever been throughout aviation history because of the equipment compared to the...
Yeah, in the Mirage, it was just manual bloody guesswork kind of thing. The site wasn't really made for, you know, dropping bombs, but, you know, yeah.
I never asked you about deployments. Did you ever drop anything in anger?
No, I didn't. No, I did two Cape Thunders, managed to miss all the nastiness along the way. So, you know, good timing in that regard. But I was a photo reconnaissance pilot in Southeast Asia, and that's all I can say about that.
All right, fair enough. good stuff. Yeah. This is fun. I don't know, Frawls. Like I said, I don't have an agenda to ask you things. I just thought I'd make you suffer through your burgeoning cold here a little bit. But what else is there? You've already said you've got the P-51 front seat. That's the climax, huh?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, pretty much. Right. Still working on that.
Yeah, well, we're just about to have an episode on that here on our show. We've started covering more warbirds. Yeah. So that's good.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, no, I'd just really like to get a hold of one and, you know, have a fly of it. There's one that may become available, but it's having an engine overhaul at the moment. So, and the heads are in the States. So COVID being what it is, it's going to take a while for them to get shipped back out to Australia. So, yeah.
Everything takes longer than you would wish. How about being home now more? This isn't necessarily related to flying, but just for fun, since we saw your wife in the background, is she trying to tell you to get another job, or does she like having you home?
Yes and no. I spend a fair bit of time working on the boat, as I said, and, you know, mucking around with my cars and things like that. So, you know, pretty much, you know, the boat goes away to do testing at various venues around the place to, you know, make sure that it's balanced and that's good. So I have the odd weekend away from time to time, which gives her some relief, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. I'm really, really enjoying retirement. I really am. It's so a little pressure, and I'm really busy, you know. So just loving life really at the moment, you know.
Good for you.
Since I can go and fly a jet every now and then, that's great. Yeah.
That is great. Absolutely. Well, do me a favor. If you ever make it to the States, specifically Southern California, please let me know. It'd be great to shake your hand, COVID permitting, and buy you a refreshment or something.
Yeah. No, that'd be good. Yeah, we do go to the States from time to time. We go to Aspen skiing. It takes us 2 years to save it up, but that's worth it.
Well, I'm right across the bay from the USS Midway. I don't know if you ever had a chance to come and tour that or any other naval carriers. But
I've seen photographs of that. Yeah, it's pretty impressive. Yeah.
Quite. Awesome. All right, Frawls. Well, tell you what, don't leave, but I'm going to hit stop here and we'll wrap it up. So really appreciate you joining me today.
Yeah, no worries, mate. It's been great. It's always good to just shoot the breeze, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Hey, thanks for watching this episode of the Fighter Pilot Podcast. I hope you enjoyed it and learned something new. I still do every episode. Now, as a quick reminder, we try to explain all the jargon, but in case you missed something, head on over to fighterpilotpodcast.com where we have a glossary of all the different terms we use. And while you're there, check out some of the cool merchandise that we offer. For additional content and to help support the show, please go check out our Patreon page. We'll see you next week.